nearly 1,500 Spanish explorers in the fields of Columbus charted a large peninsula landmass in the New World north of Cuba. Hence the name named it Flores, Land of Flores. During the following decades, Spanish attempts at permanent colonization never materialized, and Spanish rule declined. The Aboriginal Indians, the first inhabitants of the land, were virtually wiped out by European diseases. A new Indian population, renegades from the Creek and Miccosukee tribes, entered into Florida, the fierce Seminoles. Bloodthirsty pirates made camps on deserted beaches and raided passing ships. But the huge, unpopulated Florida wilderness, with its tremendous abundance of fish and game, remained essentially unchanged. This was the setting when the first American pioneers arrived at the river once called Rio de Manatee, and the area now known as Manatee County. In 1842, Congress passed the Armed Occupation Act to encourage Americans to populate the Florida wilderness. Any adult U.S. citizen could obtain free 160 acres and military protection, providing they would cultivate and live on the plain for 5 consecutive years. One of these courageous pioneers was Josiah Gates, who arrived aboard a sloop captained by Frederick Preston. Gates brought his family and 6 slaves to live in a log cabin, becoming one of the first tenants on the Manatee River. The crude log house the Gates built, and made open to travelers for lodging, was similar to most Florida wilderness dwellings. The Manatee land proved fertile, and nearly every homesteader, regardless of personal wealth, grew crops such as rice, corn, beans, tobacco, potatoes, and melons for family consumption. Wild game, such as bear, deer, pig, and turkey, was abundant. So between fishing and hunting, the pioneers could do quite well for themselves. The settlers brought noisy cargoes of chickens, pigs, and beef cattle up the river on heavily laden boats. Oxen and mules were used for draft animals, since horses were too prone to sicken and die in the mosquito-infested lands. Many tools, farming implements, vehicles, and furnishings had to be fashioned from materials obtained. In addition to the ordinary pioneer tribulations, the dense mosquito population in combination with the summer heat truly made life miserable.
The country was undrained, ending low and flat. The water literally covered the face of the earth during the rainy season. They could ride for miles through water, and in summer the mosquitoes made life a burden.
Netting draped over frames called mosquito bars protected the settlers somewhat. But palmetto fans, shutters, and indoor smudge pots were also needed to combat this prolific pest. Yellow fever epidemics, more feared than attacked by Indians or wild animals, plagued the settlers. Since the real cause of the sickness was unknown, quarantine was strictly enforced during the outbreaks. In these days before the telegraph, word of the homesteading opportunities passed from traveler to traveler, and weekly newspapers ran government land office ads. Soon, in rapid order, sections were staked out on both sides of the river. By 1843, land office records showed about 50 claims. Nearly two-thirds were single men. Some settlers were immigrants. The Bavarian couple, Joseph and Julia Etzerath, homesteaded on Terracea Island. Dr. Joseph Braden and his brother Hector arrived and began development of their combined claims on a large scale. Their sugar mill, seen here as ruins which no longer exist, bordered Sugar House Creek and Braden River, which provided an avenue of transportation on the Manatee. The Braden plantation to the west became known as Braden Town and is the original site of today's Braden. The Braden home was built where Braden River meets the Manatee. The ruins became known popularly as Braden Castle. One of Tallahassee's plantation families came Major Robert Gable, a veteran of the Second Seminole War, trying to restore a family fortune lost during the National Depression. He wrote, "For the 1850 season, I erected a mill house, 40 by 40, walls 16 feet high. All of these bricks were made on the spot by my own force and one bricklayer. But one of the South's largest and most productive sugar mills, only ruins exist today. The Gable plantation eventually included 3,500 acres, 150 slaves, and a magnificent Harlem mansion. The durable construction of the mansion, ingeniously made from an oyster shell mixture called tabby, shows the pioneer's knack for adapting native details and is stronger today than most modern bakers." Not all the pioneers stayed near the Manatee, of course. William Whitaker and his stepbrother, Hamlin Snell, established a homestead in the area south of Manatee, which years later became the community of Sarasota. Schooners hugging the farther coast along the trade route from New Orleans to Havana began making stops at new settlements along the way. They carried molasses, fish, sugar, tobacco, dry goods, and occasionally gold. Overland travel was hazardous, if not impossible, so eventually all trade and commerce was transported by water, from skiffs to steamboats. At the Manatee River, at the head of steamboat navigation, the Army built Fort Hamer during the Indian Scare of 1849.
Mrs. Whitaker used to tell her once they asked Philip Gorlage if they should be an uprising of the Indians and a massacre. "Would you kill them?" He said, "Yes, they would kill them easy," meaning he wouldn't torture them.
As late as 1856, Indian raids terrorized the Manatee area. The Sarasota Bay homestead of Senator Snell and William Baker was raided and burned to the ground. A neighbor died in the attack. Within a few weeks came a raid on Dr. Brady's home at nightfall. Braden and his guests repelled the Indians who plundered and took away slaves. In May of 1857, most of the surviving Seminoles under Chief Billy Bowlegs agreed to leave power. From Edmond Key, they were removed to Western reservations, bringing to an end the last of the tragic Seminole conflicts. Manatee County was created by the state legislature in 1855, the 20th year of Florida statehood. The new county covered a vast area. It contained over 5,000 square miles, extending from the Gulf of Mexico to the Kissimmee River and Lake Okeechobee. It included counties now known as Glades, Highland, DeSoto, Hardy, Charlotte, Sarasota, and of course, Manatee. The village of Manatee became the first county seat. The first courthouse was built by Ezekiel Glager on land donated by Josiah and Mary Gibbs. After almost 10 years, the county seat was transferred to Pine Level in the center of the huge county. The little courthouse there was only 20 by 30, housing all of the county business and a well-known population of fleas. The Manatee area prospered, but over the years, suddenly imposed tariffs and restrictions created an atmosphere of crisis for the agricultural sector. In 1861, anxious to defend her cultural and economic gains, Florida stepped out of the Union and onto the battlefield. After South Carolina and Mississippi, she was the third state to secede. Manatee's Ezekiel Glager was delegated to the secession Congress. Of course, Florida, including vast Manatee County, provided cattle and produce for the war effort, but these sources became ineffective as income supplies and outgoing cargoes were cut off by the federal blockade and able-bodied men and boys left for northern battles. For a Manatee family left behind, survival often depended upon living off the land. Occasional contraband from daring blockade runners, or simply doing without.
during the Civil War, the settlers had only flour occasionally when it was smuggled in. Coffee made of parched corn, sometimes of parched potatoes, and they tried poaching all sorts of things for it. They had venison galore and turkeys, ducks, and quail.
Troops often came ashore to forage for food, confiscate stock, and destroy property and equipment that might contribute to the Confederate cause.
And when this happened, they could see them coming in the bay, and they always ran the cattle back off what cattle they had for milk. They run them back off in the country and turn all the chickens loose and scatter them out through the ridge, you know, so the Yankees couldn't get them.
At the close of the war, veterans returning to their homes discovered that nearly everything had been destroyed. In May 1865, the Gamble Mansion was a focal point for the dangerous and daring escape of Judah P. Benjamin, Secretary of State of the Confederacy. The Northern Press urged the capture and prosecution of Jefferson Davis and his cabinet members. Mr. Benjamin's plans were to make for the British Bahamas and then Europe. After reaching Florida in disguise, Benjamin found refuge at the Gamble Mansion, then occupied by the Archibald McNeil family. When federal troops arrived at the plantation looking for McNeil, a suspected blockade runner, Benjamin McNeil narrowly avoided capture by escaping into the woods while 8-year-old Alice Burke helped to distract the soldiers with conversation. Later, her uncle Hiram McLeod, a Confederate veteran, helped Captain Frederick Custer steer Benjamin through the Union blockade in John Kerry's small open state. Leaving from Whitaker Bayou, Benjamin survived storms and shipwreck before reaching Nassau and finally England, where he enjoyed a distinguished career in British law and eventual appointment to Queen's Council. The Gamble Mansion, which had outlived plantation days, weathered hurricanes and survived the Indian Wars, in later years fell into a state of disrepair. Restoration began in 1925 after it was donated to the state of Florida through the efforts of the Judah P. Benjamin Chapter of the United Daughters of the Confederacy. It was included in the National Register of Historic Places as the only surviving antebellum plantation house in South Florida. During the Reconstruction years in Florida, the centuries-old cattle industry once again flourished. As the famed cattle days of the Wild West were just beginning to unfold, the plains of the Myakka River in Manatee received many new settlers with vast herds of livestock. In the Manatee River, steamboats were leaving with up to 120 head and pens of open decks. Cowboys drove entire herds through the floodplains as far south as Fontarosa and Charlotte Harbor. From there, cattle dealers had direct communication by telegram with the bank. Cuba remained the best market for beef, bringing gold Spanish to blooms into the slowly recovering economy. Some think the cracking of the cowboy's whip inspired the term fly back. The inland districts of Manatee County were open to steamboats and commerce when connecting waterways were cleared and dredged by Philadelphia entrepreneur Hamilton District. The frontier was coming of age. North Florida railroad lines terminated at Cedar Keys and Tampa. From there, steamship lines brought passengers, goods, and mail into Manatee.
It wasn't so long ago that Bradentown was strictly a country village. The streets were ankle deep in sand, having neither sidewalks nor hard roads. The houses were very plain, and the lawn was like an oasis in the desert. The cows were very friendly creatures and strolled the streets, even lying down to rest in our yards sometimes. And we had a few that were smart enough to open gates. I believe one of the first great issues in town was whether or not the cow must go. And I think the ladies were responsible for their banishment.
Along the banks of the Manatee River, the original settlements grew in size, many respecting the names of early pioneers. Elephant, Manatee, Malavista, Palmetto, Maidentown, Atwater, Williamsburg, Togetonville, and by the mouth of the river, Homosilla. Roads were slowly improved to surface downtown streets so as they could with Indian miners. Some streets even boasted of new wooden sidewalks and a bridge was built across Ware Street for $840. It was well worth it for the convenience. But citizens still relied on boats to cross the Manatee River. In 1887, the eastern section of Manatee, including the county seat of Pine Level, became DeSoto County. After much politicking, the county government was moved to Bradentown. A post office was established in Bradentown in 1878 with Major William I. Turner, postmaster. Due to a clerical error, it was spelled B-R-A-I-D-E-N-T-O-W-N on all maps and documents. In 1905, the extra I was dropped, but it was not until 1924 that the W was removed to modernize the name. The application of the latest farming methods in Manatee's nourishing environment created an atmosphere of experiment. Citrus groves and vegetable farms sprawled into the areas that had once been filled with sugar cane. Moving the produce was paramount now, and narrow gauge railroads on both sides of the Manatee were constructed for just that. The first train running between Bradenton and Sarasota was aptly nicknamed the Slow and Wobbly. Later, the Seaboard Airline Railroad supplied Manatee County with reliable service. Around 1896, Dr. Lewis Warren opened telephone and telegraph communication in the area. Beginning with 5 subscribers, business increased to 27 phones by spring of 1897. Especially busy during shipping season, the first switchboard and telegraph office was located in Dr. Warren's brick building, which also included an 800-seat opera house. The turn of the century was an exciting time to be alive in Manatee. Remembered event was the completion of the first bridge over the Manatee in 1902. Constructed by the Seaboard Airline Railway Company, it featured a drawbridge and depot. In 1903, a switch was thrown, and suddenly electricity was available for the first time. An electric powerhouse enabled area residents to trade oil lamps for light bulbs. Inaugurated on the same day was a trolley car line.
The streetcar used to go right by my house, and the streetcar ran from Brandon up to Manatee and then on west out to the area. I think it's 26th Street, and to the pavilion out in the river, the piles are still out there where the tournament was on the hill of the river.
Steamboats could dock at this pavilion and offload cargo directly onto the street cars. Ferry traffic across the Manatee River ended in 1910 when C.H. Davis built the first bridge, a toll bridge for pedestrians, bicycles, and carriages.
This was a one-lane bridge with turnouts on it. And this got to be an expense for the bridge travelers to figure out who's going to stop at the turnout and wait.
Eventually, due to popular demand, a free one was constructed, also of wood, and the toll bridge was removed. By then, there were newfangled machines competing with the trusty horse and buggy in Manatee County.
My dad bought his first automobile in 1914. He couldn't drive. I could. I was 14 years old. So I taught him to drive it.
Hard roads and bridges had to follow. These new automobiles couldn't drive through soft sand or ford creeks as horse-drawn rigs could. Soon contractors were tearing and breaking the public right-of-way. Dr. Sherman Whitaker contracted to clear and grade the first hard surface road from Sarasota to Fort Myers. That road work incorporated the first red palmetto plaque. A black Manatee resident and new women had invented and patented this mechanical plow to remove the stubborn palmetto thickets that continually hampered lane clearing.
This man's idea for this plow was very ingenious. You could go an acre a day where it used to take you a week to clear an acre of ground.
To this day, local folks refer to clearing a field as wedding. Once again, war. This time, international. Loom the Manatee's horizon. Fighting raged in Europe, and in 1917, the United States entered World War I. Both combat and medical volunteers from Manatee County departed for the war overseas. The war and the waiting dragged on. Then, November the 11th, 1918.
One night about 1 or 2 o'clock, as I recall, the phone rang. And of course, this upset the house. And my dad, the phone rang, made it, and all he was saying was, yep. It's okay. And as soon as he completed that conversation, he called me up, came back, and said, now, give me the power plant. And all he sent to the power plant was, let her go. He had arranged with the night engineer at the power plant that if he called, they would have turned that whistle loose. And that's what happened.
The war was over. Peace once again settled over the families of the Manatee. The cattle industry and agriculture took on new stature with increasing population and expanding markets. In the past, an excursion to Manatee's beautiful Gulf beaches had always been an all-day affair. But soon, bridges would span the bays, making the beaches easily accessible. Manatee's ideal climate would continue to attract increasing tourism, as well as new residents. Other events and changes for Manatee County were also still in the future, but the legacy of the past remained. The pioneering spirit and the recognition of the true values in life promised a bright and prosperous future for the descendants of the early settlers of Manatee County.
Say this is the finest orchard that you ever saw in your life. There's no rough roads.
back through the woods. And if they haven't got back here, you just move over and break a path through the palmettos and start a new one. My father used to be especially northern people to help and bring them down and just start to do it. But in this always, it was a source of great amazement. How he knew which road to take when all these roads were going to take the palmettos. It didn't make any difference, really.
I'm sure that time the transportation to the islands was by boat. And if you went down to Cortez to swim at the beach, you had a fisherman to take you over and then tell them to come back for you at a certain time. If you forgot, you were just marooned on the island until you remember.
One time when they went out, it was the first northwester in November, and this was the mother to spoke. And he said that when they got to the mouth of the river, it was a school of mud, miles up the river, extending out past the point of the river, from bank to bank, and 6 foot deep. They were just literally sailing in